Hello again, YouTubers. Welcome back to the Board Game Kaptain. I'm your host, the Board Game Kaptain, and today I'm going to be reviewing and showing you how to play Thunder and Lightning. Now, this is a game designed by Richard Borg and published by Z-Man Games. Now, Richard Borg is very famous for his Commands and Colors system. It's the system that was used in such games as Memoir 44 and Battle Lore, as well as others. But this is not a game in that system. Now, most of the games he puts out, and he's put out games in that system that play from everything from fantasy warfare to World War II to the Civil War, but this is one of the few games he's done that is not in that system at all. So that in itself is a rather interesting thing. Now, this is a two-player abstract strategy card game where you're playing opposite sides of a fight in Norse mythology. One side is playing Loki, while the other side is playing Thor. The game is for ages 13 and up, and it is listed as a 40-minute game. So now I'd like to start there. So the 13 and up is a pretty good estimate. Again, though, however, if you routinely play games with a child who gets games above their age level and is just a couple years shy of that 13 mark, they're probably going to be okay with this game. The 40 minutes is something I have a bit of a problem with, because this is a game that really should have had a range, because the length of this game can vary quite a bit, and the range I would give this would be 15 minutes to an hour. And the reason I say that is because depending on how the cards are drawn, you can have a game go really fast, or you can have a game that drags on a little bit. So let's open it up and have a look at what's in the box. What do you get when you buy Thunder and Lightning? So the first thing is a very nice full color rule book. And let me show you some of the pages here. Good, they have diagrams. They fully explain all the rules. They don't leave anything unsaid, which is nice. Now they do have, which is really useful, they have references of all the cards and a full description of exactly how their abilities work on each of the different cards. Now, the primary component of this game is a pair of card decks. There is one deck for Loki, and there is one deck for Thor. Now, the decks are symmetrical. They have the same cards in them. Some of them have different names, but they'll have the same effect as a card in the other's deck. So for instance, each deck has only one god card in it of, in this case, Loki, and in this case, Thor, that give you the ability to draw extra cards while you have them in play. The artwork on the cards is very nice. Here is the Odin card, for instance. Nightmare. The cards show on them, they usually have a number up here, which can be zero, or in some cases, for the purpose of certain cards, they'll have no number and just a runic knot, like they have up on this card here. Now, the ones with numbers are ones that can fight on the battlefield, whereas the ones that only have a runic knot, they, on the other hand, or have a special ability to play from your hand. You can actually, there's a bluffing element to this, and you can actually put them onto the battlefield, but if they're attacked by anything with a number, they will automatically lose. So now here's a much stronger card, the Fire Giant, who has a 5. So now, after the cards, the next and final component is a pair of these wooden markers here, these pieces here. One for Thor, one for Loki. Now, these are used to remind you when, and to remind your opponent, when you have either your Thor card or your Loki card out, you put this on the card. And there it is, it sits there. These are really, strictly speaking, these are not necessary for the game. They're cool, they look nice, they make a nice little reminder. It's a little bit of an extra thing that they did for you. I'm not gonna complain about it, but It kind of, after I read the rules, it was a little bit of a head scratcher to me why they bothered paying to have these made, except that they look nice. And they do, they look nice. So that is a look at what comes in the box. Now this game plays very oddly. There's some It has a lot of elements from other strategy card games that you might be familiar with, especially dueling games, one-on-one games, things similar to, say, Magic the Gathering, for instance. But on the other hand, it's also got a lot of elements that remind me of the classic board game Stratego, especially the bluffing element of Stratego, where when you're moving pieces forward to attack your opponent's pieces, you don't know until they attack what piece it is, because this has a very similar mechanic in it. So let's head over to the table and I'll show you how it's played, and you can see what I mean when I say it reminds me of Stratego. Then we'll come back, I'll review it, I'll rate it, and we'll get a second opinion from Lynn. Okay, so here we can see a game setup of Thunder and Lightning. Now, you've got your deck to your right, depending on who you are. So Thor is on this side of the table, his deck's to the right, and then Loki's on this side of the table, and his deck is to his right. And you draw 9 cards. If you draw either Odin's crown or Odin's ring in your starting 9 cards, you're allowed to shuffle it back into the deck and draw a card to replace it. The reason for this is because Odin's crown or Odin's ring, and there's one is in one deck and the other is in the other deck, if your opponent causes you to discard that card, the game is over and you lose. So you don't really want it right away. You're hoping it's going to be pretty low to the bottom of the deck if possible. There are 2 ways to lose it, to win this game. One is to cause your opponent to discard either Odin's crown or Odin's ring. The other way is to make it so that your opponent loses all of their columns. Now, from your starting 9 cards, you choose 3 cards and start your 3 columns. Now, you have up to 3 columns, and you can have them in up to 4 rows. So for instance, later while playing cards, I can play cards all the way back to here. If I was Thor, that would be one column that is 4 rows deep. I might have this one with 2 cards on it and this one with 2 cards on it, and that would look like a well-played further in setup. Now, on your turn, you're allowed to do a number of actions equal to the number of columns you still have functional. So to start with, both players can do 3 actions on their turn. The possible actions are draw a card, play a card onto the battlefield, which you can do in one of 2 different ways. You can either just play it to the back of one of the columns, or you can play it anywhere within the column, and if it's in front of other cards, it will push them further back, like this. The third action is to challenge an opponent's card. Now, the way you generally do that is you take a card and you say, he's going to challenge, you both reveal what they are, and whoever has the higher number destroys the opposite card and it is discarded. However, neither player may challenge on their first turn, which guarantees that both players will get at least 3 actions for their first turn. Now, the reason I say at least 3 is because if one of the first cards you played is either the Thor card or the Loki card, that card specifically allows you to get 4 actions. That's the only way you can go above the normal 3. So you take your actions based on the number of columns you have, and then it's your opponent's turn. So let me show you how this works. So I'm going to start. The first player is going to be Thor, and again, on his first turn, he cannot challenge. So Thor is going to start. First action, he's going to draw a card. Second action, he's going to play a card in front of this one here. Now, if you don't remember, you can always check what a card is before deciding whether you want to go in front or behind, but I did remember what that was. And for my third action, I'm going to play a card in the back here. So now it's Loki's turn. So Loki has 3 actions, and for Loki's first action, Loki is going to draw a card, then Loki is going to play a card there, and Loki is going to draw another card. So back to Thor. Now Thor is able to challenge now because it is his second turn. So Thor is going to take a look and remind himself what he has in a couple places. He's going to say, okay, he's going to play the Raven. Now, a Raven is a card that could be played as a one-strength card on the battlefield, but it has an ability that allows it to challenge straight from your hand. So I'm going to use the Raven to challenge this card here. So we flip this card over. We see that it is a Frost Giant. The Raven, of course, loses and gets discarded. But now I know what's there. And I know what will happen if I challenge it. So I decide then for my second action to draw another card. And for my third action to play another card. So now it is Loki's turn. And Loki takes a look and says, you know what? I'm going to use my Raven on this card here. We flip it over and we see it is a shield wall. Now the shield wall is something that it has zero strength, but if any card with a number of any card challenges the shield wall, it will lose with the only exception of a female archer. So for Loki's second action, he's going to play another card here. And for his final action, he's going to challenge, flipping this over to reveal a female archer, knocking Thor down to 2 columns, which means now Thor can only take 2 actions on his turn. So Thor takes a quick look and says, you know what? I'm going to play the Thor card, which actually gets played face up. And the Thor card says it does not cost an action to play. And now, because I have played it, it gives me 4 actions to use during my turn, even on the turn in which I played it. And Thor cannot be challenged and destroyed. So you have to get rid of Thor, you have to challenge it with a Raven from your hand. So that Loki will have to do that. So now I have 4 actions still to do. So first action, Thor will draw a card. Second action, Thor will draw a card. Third action, Thor's going to challenge here. Flip over, he's got a Forest Troll, which is a strength 4. And Loki flips over and shows that he has a Frost Giant, also strength 4. They destroy each other. So, then it will be Loki's turn, and also, again, Loki is now down to 2 actions because of the fact that he only has 2 columns. So Loki decides to play a card here for his first action and draw a card for his second. And this is how the game goes. It goes back and forth like this. And you want to definitely try to keep yourself at 3 columns if you can, because less columns means you don't get the full 3 actions. It's very important. When your opponent gets either the Thor or Loki card out, you desperately want to get your hands on a Raven so you can get rid of it. So then you're going to be doing a lot of draw actions to try to find a Raven to destroy the Thor or Loki card. Now, the Ravens are actually allowed to challenge a card from your hand. So if let's say Loki played a Raven and he said, I want to challenge a card in your hand, you fan your cards out and they pick one of them. And in that case, if it is a card with a number on it, Loki gets to place it face up in your first row somewhere. But if it is a card without a number, it gets discarded. And that includes Odin's ring and Odin's crown. So keeping it in your hand is not the safest bet. Generally, it's a good idea to hide it somewhere towards the back of one of these columns. But you would definitely want to have some good defensive things there. And that is not a foolproof method of concealing it either, because your opponent has ways of moving things around and possibly killing the things in front of it. But that's how the game plays. So let's head back. I'm going to tell you how it feels. I'm going to review it and rate it. And we're going to get a second opinion from Lynn.
Okay, so that was how you play a game of Thunder and Lightning. Now, I want to mention one gripe I have with this game before we get started on the positives of this game. So there is a listing, a thorough listing on exactly how each of these cards works in the back of the book. Now, while it's good to go over them and have a thorough listing, a lot of these cards they could have filled up more of the card with text. I mean, I know they don't want to cover up these pictures. There's some very nice pictures, but they never cover up more of the picture than, say, this card here. Tiny little amount down there. They could have filled up about half this card with text. You still see the picture through the text. And they could have fit a lot more on there. And there's some of these that, in some cases, work significantly different than they sound like they should work on the card. You have to look them up. And you look them up and you say, oh, that was not how I thought this worked. One card in particular that this is a real issue with, in my opinion, because the first time I played with it, I was playing it wrong. Until I looked it up and I noticed that I was playing it wrong, is, let me just find him here. There he is, Vidar. So here is Vidar. Now, Vidar says, have the leftmost / rightmost card in your first row challenge any card in your opponent's rightmost / leftmost column. So that's cool. It's a way to get around and challenge cards in the back, on the back of the column, either on the left side or the right side. That would, if your opponent is hiding, you know, Odin's ring or Odin's crown back there, it's a great way to get to it. But then I went and I looked in here and I saw that I was kind of misunderstanding how he worked, because the way he's written on the card, it doesn't sound like he should work how he works. When you read him in here, it says, discard Vidar from your hand to have a card in the first row of your right or left column make a flanking challenge. When you challenge with a first row card in your right column, you may challenge any card in any row with your opponent of your opponent's left column. Only their left column if you're using the one in your right column. When you challenge with the first card in your left column, you may only charge any card in any row of your opponent's right-hand column. So, how hard would it have been to increase the text box up to, say, about his chin, and say, instead of the way it's written here, have it say, have the leftmost card in your first row challenge any card in your opponent's left column, or have the rightmost card in your first row challenge any card in your opponent's left column. If you'd have spelled it out like that, it would have made more sense, and you wouldn't have this bit of confusion. So I do have a bit of an issue with that. I really think they should have increased the size of the text boxes and had the full rules for each card actually be on the card. I shouldn't have to look it up in the book to understand how the card works. And in a few cases, not all of them and not even most, but in a few cases like Vidar, that really is how it is. So I do have a bit of a gripe with that. That being said, the game itself is a lot of fun. And you saw what I meant when I said it reminds me of Stratego. So you've got this card and it's face down and you say, I challenge the card in front of me. Flip them up, let's see what we got. And once you flip them up, then they stay up, because then everybody knows what's there. And similar to Stratego, you have traps. The shield walls can't attack, but if someone challenges them, they kill anything except for a female archer who's only strength 2. There's another trap, which is really, really cool also, which is the card, the Nightmare, which when this card is challenged, it explodes and kills everything in the entire column on both sides. If it gets challenged while it's in your hand, it destroys your entire hand. So this is a card that you want to get down on the field as quick as possible and not put too much behind it, because if it gets challenged, it's going to wipe the whole row out. And wiping the row out with this is also a good way to find those hidden Odin's crown or Odin's ring that might be all the way at the back of that long column there. In addition, Odin's crown and Odin's ring really feel like the flag in Stratego. So this is a new twist on an old mechanic that we haven't seen redone very much. And for that, I think this is great. This is really cool. I wish some other old school games like Stratego would, I wish some designers would take their mechanics and bring them into the modern gaming environment like Richard Board did with this game. This is a really cool idea. The game plays really well. I thoroughly enjoy it. This is one of those games that I like to take with Lynn and I when we go over to have a cup of coffee at the coffee house, and we'll play a game of this. We've done that a couple times now. I give Thunder and Lightning 7 out of 10 stars because I enjoyed this game. I will play this game anytime someone asks me to play this game. And I'm going to ask to play this game sometimes in the future when I'm in the mood for this style of game. It is a cool game, and it's very fun, and I do enjoy it. That being said, let's get a second opinion from Lynn. Lynn, how many stars out of 10 would you give to Thunder and Lightning?
7.
So Lynn is in total agreement with me. This is a solid 7-star game, which means it is really good, and both of us will play it anytime somebody asks. So there you have it. So do you have any questions or comments either on the game Thunder and Lightning or on this video? Please put them in the comments down below. And if you enjoyed this video and you would like to see us do more like it, please give us a like, share this video, and if you haven't already, please subscribe to the Board Game Kaptain on YouTube. That is Kaptain spelt with a K. And until next time, game on.